Now we're on session 4 of the agenda. We're going to look at using the print preview screen in CorelDRAW, define and use the imposition layout tool along with print merge, and creating a tool and fixture with the laser engraving machine, laser cutter. Now to get a look at this, I wanted to show these are the items that we'll cover. Again, the print preview, imposition, print merge, and fixture making for production. So this kind of is an overview page showing what we're going to go through. But this would be the heart of this webinar or tutorial session. And what I mean by that is it really shows a lot of the power in CorelDRAW and how you can take what you learn in this session and really excel and move forward with making money with your machine, increasing production and revenue. So to do that, we're going to show how to make multiple pages with the print preview screen, and doing that with the imposition layout tool, we can actually apply different names and variable data called print merge into those impositions, and we can apply all of that to some fixtures we've made with the laser machine. So I want to slide over to the internet for just a moment, and I'm going to go up to the Epilogue homepage, where we'll find in the resources tab a sample club. So I want to show a specific example, a sample of using the laser to make a fixture. So we're talking about coming up with an outline of an image or a tool, and that tool can be represented by a dog tag, a metal plate, a keychain, anything that you need to kind of hold down and make more of. Sometimes it's easier even to make a fixture for just one project or for one object if it may be odd shaped, just to get it straight. So for example, using the laser to cut through a fixture, to cut through some material such as foam, wood, acrylic, setting that object in that place and then engraving to that location. That is a very powerful and productive way to use your laser machine. So that is the example I want to build off of. That's where we're headed. And how are we going to make that in CorelDRAW? And that's going to require us defining some key elements in CorelDRAW. So we're going to look at first the print preview screen, and we're going to build a layout. So I have an example I would like to use by using a knife blade. Let's say for a wedding, some groomsmen are going to want their names on several knives. So if that's the order, we need to come up with a fixture to hold the knives, and then we need a way to put each different name on those knives. So I kind of have a sort of overview of what we're looking at from creation or scan. This would be the scan picture image that you could find on the internet, and how it has been traced and modified as an outline so that we can cut that out in the foam or cardboard or wood or acrylic to use as fixture material. So we're using this final vector line art image to do the cutting, and then we're going to apply the text to that location. So here's how that's going to look. I'm going to show you how you would take an image from scratch and build a fixture for that. So the first thing we're going to do is make a new page in CorelDRAW. So we're going to call this Kershaw Knife. Now again, don't get too hung up on this being a Kershaw knife. This could be a set of uppers and lowers for an AR. It could be ammunition magazines. It could be for the firearm industry, woodworking industry, promotional products industry. So there's many different industries that could take advantage of using CorelDRAW in this manner. So we're going to measure the physical dimension of the knife that's opened up, and that's going to measure at 6 inches wide and about 1¼ inches tall. So this becomes our new page. So what we want is to end up here with is an outline of a knife. Alright, so how are we going to get that? Let's go out to the internet once more. And let's find, we're going to go to Google. And we'll just type out Kershaw knives. Now, I'm going to point out some other tips that you might not know about in Google and other search engines. You have, when you search for an object, you have the ability to click on images. And this displays hundreds, if not millions, of objects relating or photographs relating to that search. So I would bet that almost in any case you could come up with an outline that matched the size or the part or close to the object you're trying to match. In fact, I see my exact knife that I commonly use here. So I'm going to select that object, that knife, and I'm going to click on View Image. And that is the image that I want to cut out. So I'm going to right-click on that and save that image as, let's just put it in my, let's go to my desktop, and we'll put it right on the desktop, Kershaw knife. So now that my bitmap image has been saved from the internet, I have found it. Now, by the way, you can change your criteria of search. You can use images and change your search tools to different sizes. So hopefully this is a good tip for some of you. You could change it to search only the images that are in large format. They give me a large resolution. Maybe you want to say only search for something in full color, or maybe just black and white. Maybe you want to search for only images that are made of clip art, or maybe like a line drawing. You see the different versions of these graphics that you are able to pull from. So the search criteria in these different search engines can be a big help. I've also noticed here recently the usage rights has been popped up. So if you have things like university seals or sports or NCAA names, maybe some of those that you search for, it will give you the license reusability here. All right, so let's go back to our job, and we're going to import the Kershaw knife that we downloaded to the desktop. I'm going to push the Enter key, and that will center this knife picture on our page. Now remember, all we really want is an outline. Step one of this whole job is going to be to cut out an outline fixture of this knife. So what I'm going to do is go up to Trace Bitmap, and as we look at the definition, Trace Bitmap, it will convert a bitmap to a vector object. So let me say it another way. It will convert pixels to lines. And those lines we can cut out with the laser. And that's going to be my fixture cutout. So I'm going to click Trace Bitmap Outline of a Logo. And some of you may be asking, well, what if you choose logo, or what if you choose detailed logo? Well, each one of these have different amounts that it picks up in the trace. I really don't have a magic solution on why one will always be better than another. I just always choose detailed logo or logo to see what I get and change accordingly. Okay, but again, we don't need every bit of detail here. We just need some to show the area. Now, looking at the top part, we might want to put a logo up there. So if we have a way to get actually line art where it shows this area up here, then we might want to see that. We probably don't need to see the serrated part, but we'll go ahead and just use this one and see how that works out for us. We're actually going to tell it to remove the background, so that got rid of all of that background shadowing area. And let's say we're ready to click OK. So it's going to place my outline or my traced image right on top of my bitmap, and I'm going to move that off just a moment. So using my really handy view and wireframe, we see that one is made of pixels and one is made of lines. Very helpful to know that. So we'll go back to View, Working and Enhanced, and now we're ready to get to work. So we're going to select both of these images, and I'm going to rotate that by clicking the rotation handles. So I probably did that too fast. I'm going to select all of those again, and any object that you select twice, it will actually rotate. So we're going to click on that to rotate that to see if we can get that somewhat flat and level. Again, our knife is going to be placed in the area that we cut, so it doesn't necessarily have to be perfect at this point, but just for viewing and easier to see. All right, so I'm going to select, this is the curved object. Now, how do you know that I have the curved object selected? Well, we see at the bottom that it's the group of 18 objects. Now, that's not always a true indicator that you're not using the bitmap, but by and large, since we just traced, we can kind of gather that. We can also look at the object manager. The object manager shows us very specifically which object we have selected at a time. Very helpful to use the object manager. By the way, I'm also going to, with the object manager selected, I'm going to use the shape or the crop tool, and I'm going to crop around the area of just the knife. See if I can get rid of some of that extra space so it's easier to see our trace. Alright, so using the crop tool, I'm going to double click, and that should get rid of that area. So here we have the picture and the outline. Alright, so what we'd like to do is we want to come up with, as I mentioned before, an outline, and this knife really needs to be the full length. So I'm going to key in with a little padlock here. I'm going to lock that ratio down to 6 inches wide. And so that's just a little over 1.27 inches tall. Then let's make our page 1.27 to match. Okay. Alright, so with that selected, we're going to group those objects and push the letter P to center that mathematically. And now we're really close to getting where we need to be. Alright, so now that we have traced our pixel image, and we have our, oh, I've got those grouped, let's ungroup those. I want to move one of those, I want to keep the vector image away from the bitmap for a moment. No, it didn't ungroup, let's try that. Control U. Now it's ungrouped. Alright, so this is the group of 18 objects, and this is the picture, or the bitmap. I really can get rid of this one at this point. I won't just yet, so you can just keep that for reference. But what I want to do is come up with an outline for this. And to do that as an outline, I'm going to click on Object, Shaping, and Boundary. A very important tool, very powerful, shaping and boundary. By one click, that will create an outline curve all the way around that knife for us. So with just a click, I've created an outline that I'm going to use as my cut line. Taking something from the internet or a smartphone for the object that you need to create a fixture for, scan that, take a picture of it, bring it in, trace it, come up with an outline trace that you can use. Again, it doesn't have to be perfect, because all we needed to do is hold the knife steady while it's being engraved. Alright, so with this done, now we're ready to keep that outline over that. And again, I'm just keeping that there for reference for a moment. We may delete that in a moment. But we have what's listed in our object manager, very important to pay attention to your object manager. What I'd like to do is type out some, or a name or a placeholder for a name here. I'm going to type groomsman. Alright, so we're going to type in groomsman, and I need to really get this set in size the way I want it to appear. Maybe they like a stronger font. Let's use something a little more bold. Yeah, that wouldn't be a bad font to use. So with that one selected, we're going to size this accordingly where it'll fit on the knife blade. So we know that there's a line right above this area here for reference that would kind of drag across that area. So we're just putting that name right about this area for our name. All right. So to keep you in the loop on where we're headed, again, we are using the outline, the red outline hairline, to cut out a fixture. What I'm going to do now is select only the red outline. That's all I have selected. I'm going to click on Print. Now let me preface this and say what I'm doing now could also be used for sublimation and many other things. But I'm gearing this for a laser system, so I'm going to choose a laser engraving machine. We'll choose the Mini. And I'm going to print by selection. So printing by selection means it's only going to print or send to my printer only that which I have clicked. And I only have the outline clicked. So since I want to use this as a cut of a fixture, I'm going to go to Preferences. Now my preferences show the size of my table of my Mini laser. So that is 24 by 12. That's my cutting area, table size of my laser machine. Can you tell me maybe why that outline is in the center of that page? Well, CorelDRAW, as we said early on in the webinar, CorelDRAW is not laser software. It's made for printing business cards and newsletters, print media primarily. But it does a very good job of helping us create layouts or impositions. And so, by default, CorelDRAW gives us or applies automatic margins that centers your page. So this knife is the center of the page, or my page that is centered on my printer device. I hope you're catching that relationship. That's super important. My page is in the center of my print device. And there's nothing that you did or I did for that to happen. We just click print. CorelDRAW does that automatically. That's the bad news. CorelDRAW, there's not a way that we can apply an upper left for our laser machine that usually is in the upper left-hand corner as a point of origin. So what we have to do is create a custom impose or a custom imposition. I'm going to click on the Layout tab, and I want you to see that in the Layout tab we have all kinds of booklet, tint card, side fold, brochure. These are printer type impositions or imposes. What we're going to do is say we want to move this to the upper left corner. When we click on Print Preview, there I see my one knife page in my big printer. So to create your imposition, we have other videos that relate to this, but I'll step through it quickly. We're going to click on the Imposition tool, click on Edit Basic Settings, click on Edit Margins. We're going to uncheck the Auto Margin and watch where it goes, straight to the upper left corner of my machine. That's exactly where I wanted it to go. If maybe I had one, if this was just a one-time thing, then we could set that as one object there. Furthermore, we're going to go back to basic settings, and I'm going to make sure I have maintained that size down. I never want CorelDRAW to decrease or increase the size of that. So I want to be sure that I have maintained that size of this, that it never changes. All right, so again, I'm going to click on the page and show what we have is one outline. This is what we're going to cut for a fixture out of that tool foam that I showed you a picture of. Okay, so we need to cut this out, but we can't have that so close to the edge. So we're doing all this to cut the fixture, and then we're going to print to the fixture. Therefore, as we start, we're going to click on Edit Basic Settings, choose Edit Margins, and we're going to click on, let's see, my screen didn't refresh here. Let's go back. Imposition Tool, Edit Margins. Now this is the Auto Margin, and I may have an issue where my screen isn't refreshing. I've seen this in other monitors on different computers. I'm going to close the preview down for a moment. I'm going to come back into Print Preview and go back to Edit Margins. Don't know why that happens, but I've seen it happen in other computers. So Edit Margins is now active. It allows me to increase the size or the margin from the left edge of my machine, from the top and the left, and all sides actually. But we're just going to say we want a 1-inch by 1-inch margin. So that positions my page 1 inch down and 1 inch from the left. So hopefully that you're seeing kind of where we're headed here as we click on basic settings. Now I'm going to increase the number of pages to the right and down. Therefore, that allows us, since we have more than that, we can change the guttering in between. Now again, I have a screen refresh issue, so I'm going to click, let's see if we can maybe get out of that. Yeah, here we go. So by choosing our imposition tool, we're going to keep that as Edit Basic Settings, and I'm going to click this little pair of scissors here. And this is a edit gutter in the vertical. I'm going to keep those equal and say we need a 1/2 inch in between. And then I'm going to go back to basic settings. I still have my 2x2. And I do that on purpose because my screen isn't refreshing. So I'm going to go now back to clicking on the scissors. And that should show 0, but it doesn't. That's CorelDRAW or my monitor's mistake. And so I'm going to type in 0.6 just because it wouldn't let me type in 0.5, which was already there. So I have to lie to it, tell it 0.5. Now it's got an accurate 1/2 inch margin. So it's got a 1/2 inch margin for our layout. So I want you to picture this 12x24 sheet being or applying to a piece of foam or maybe a quarter inch piece of acrylic, or a piece of wood, cardboard, mat board, you name it. You could use just about any kind of material to create a fixture from. Alright, so we've got two across, two down. Let's increase the number of pages to the right and the number of pages down. Let's see how many we can get liberally on this layout. So 18 knives, that would be a pretty good number for a fixture. So we are going to now go to margins and tell it to increase that to the right a little more, maybe 2 inches. Now that's about right. So earlier we mentioned that we have a bunch of custom impositions in here that we can create and save so that we don't lose this work, the 3 across, 6 down, correct margins in between and so forth, so that you don't lose that. We can actually save that as a custom imposition. So we're going to call this Kershaw Knife Jig Template 3 across, 6 down, and 18. So I'm going to save that in the list of impositions, and now that is saved in this menu, even though it's probably not here because of my refresh rate. I'm going to close down my print preview, and that should show in my layout list right here, and it does. So to recap, we can click our imposition and say we'd like to do just one in the upper left-hand corner, or we can tell it to do many by choosing our fixture, which is 3 across, 18 knives this way. So now that we've made our fixture, we would actually send this to the laser cutter. Our fixture is ready to be cut. So we're going to send this to our laser. In this particular laser, we have our printer driver. We would set that to vector, probably a slow speed and full power to cut through some foam or cardboard or acrylic. So as it goes through and prints and cuts all of these, you're going to hold up in your hand out of the laser all of those shapes cut out and holes for your knives to fit into. Alright, so that's part A, is creating the fixture. So I hope you again get the relationship between your page in CorelDRAW and when you click on print, what your printer device is saying, is telling you, showing you over here. If you don't have the preview over here, you need to click these little double arrows, and that's what shows that open. Alright, so now that we have our fixture made, we are ready to start applying and filling up the fixture with the knives and engraving some names. Alright, so that this name, I don't really want my names getting outside that area, so I have to do something with CorelDRAW to make that name fit. Now, mechanical engraving machines have all along the ability to force that to stay within a certain margin. CorelDRAW just doesn't have anything like that automatically, so we have to manually make something. And that makes something is called the envelope. So we have to apply an envelope to this name or placeholder, and that envelope is going to make our text fit right in within that area. Okay, let's get started. So to apply an envelope to that line of text, we are going to click on Effects, Envelope. And what we will do is simply click. There's two clicks to do this. Add new. So you see the different ghosting border marquee box around it. And if you look real close, when I click apply, it's going to shift that text just a little bit. Just nudged it a hair to show us now that that text is fit to that envelope. Now it will keep that text in that area. Now our dilemma comes is we don't want to type in all of those names manually, especially if our bride has emailed us a list of names over email, or if this is a trophy plate or a plaque or a name badge and our company already has this in the front office in Excel. What we want to do is use a CSV file. So to use a file that somebody's already made a spreadsheet of, you want to look for the CSV file from Excel. Or Google Sheets can actually save your data as a CSV file. Once your CSV file is saved and available, we're ready to apply that file to our print merge. I'm going to type this in from scratch so you can see how print merge works. We are going to click on File and Print Merge. And for print merge, we're going to tell it to create or load these fields. Now, what's interesting about this print merge wizard in CorelDRAW is we never get out of the wizard. We either create new text from this wizard, right here, or we import text and fields from a file, which is that CSV file that I mentioned. So we're either typing text in this wizard, or we're bringing data, the CSV file, into this wizard. But you stay working within this wizard. So I'm going to do this from scratch, and I'm going to click New Text, and let's just call this Groomsman. So I'm going to add that as a field name. Now, for your information, for fields, this kind of represents a spreadsheet. So the field is the header, the labeling up top of a spreadsheet, and then the data is found as we enter that here. So we have the field name, and we have the data. Now, you can have many different text fields, and in fact, if your client sends you a spreadsheet with name and city and state, badge number, farm, tank number, road, street, all of those variables may show up here if you import a CSV file, but that's okay. You don't have to go fix their spreadsheet. You can leave it alone and just be able to cherry pick which field names you want to use. So I have field name, and we have lines of text we're going to enter here as the groomsman. Let's just come in here and type, let's do so seven names or 7,000 names, it doesn't matter. But again, if I had imported a spreadsheet, that data I would be seeing right here all listed out for me. When we click Next, we are ready to finish this data. Now, I'll save this as a CSV file so we can go back and take a look at what that might look like if we were to import that. So we'll just call this Groomsman Names, saving that to the desktop. Let me maybe put that on a particular desktop. All right, that's VMware, shared folders, desktop. Okay, so now that our groomsmen's names are applied, we are ready to, well, we could edit the print merge. If I had more names that needed to be added to this list, we can do that from this field right up here. Maybe let me just get rid of this down here. So we need to replace this with our insert print merge field. All right, so let's select our highlight. Probably the easiest way would be, and I see where I've made a mistake. I really applied the envelope too soon. So I'm going to delete that, because I don't believe I can insert that with that envelope just like that. So what I've got to do is insert this print merge field, and then I'm going to reproduce it over here. Now notice, since I inserted the print merge field, it has the carrots on each side, making sure that it stays within that area. So here is our real variable. And so since it has the right nomenclature there, I'm going to click Add New Envelope, and then Apply. So you want to do your envelope actually after you've inserted your field from your database or from your list. All right, now we are ready to basically not perform the print merge. We could choose Perform Print Merge, but let me caution you not to use Perform Print Merge. What this does is actually performs the merge to this template, and we're really not ready for that yet. We're ready to choose Merge to New Document. Merge to New Document will actually merge the data to pages and creates it as a new file. So if I mess up, I can come back to this default or this template, make any changes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, let's just get rid of the bitmap for clarity. And then I would like to take this a little further with our object manager. What I'd like you to see is that your object manager can be used a very powerful way. We can take the outline, the curve, which is found right here, and then the group of objects, which is the trace of the knife, and then the text. All we really want to engrave at this point is the text. So we don't want to be able to move the bitmap or the curve or the trace. So we are going to go to the Object Manager and create a new layer. We're going to create a new layer and call this the fixture layer. And in the fixture layer, we are going to apply the curve and the group of objects. And guess what we're going to do to that particular layer? We are going to turn off the printability to that layer, and we're going to lock that layer down. So we cannot accidentally select that layer or select objects within that layer, and they won't be printed. So all it's going to do is focus on groomsmen in this active layer 1. I might want to even rename that to engraving layer. So this is a powerful, great way to set up your fixtures. All right, so now I'm going to go ahead and save what I have so far. I've gone through a lot of work to do that. So we're saving that as Kershaw Knife. Now what we'd like to do is go ahead and merge the new document. So notice how many pages we have at the bottom. Page 1. This is called our Kershaw Knife CDR. Watch what happens when we click Merge to New Document. And I don't believe you have to have that selected. So we're just going to say, with nothing selected, merge that to a new document. Excellent. What it has done, thank you CorelDRAW, is applied a name to each one of those, and it has made it fit within those margins and shrunk the name accordingly. I hope you see that that is just a fantastic way to take a list of names and apply that. We might want to engrave this on the blade, or if it's a wooden handle, have a number or a logo here. But using our print merge and imposition, we are ready to print all of these names to our knives. So being the heart of the seminar, what we have, we're ready to engrave. So we're going to choose print. And this time, we're only going to print that which is printed, or printable, from our layers menu, right? So now we're going to choose our Mini 24. And this time, instead of being vector for cutting, it's going to be raster for engraving. If you're using Surmark on a steel blade, you would use probably something like a slow speed. If you have a 30-watt laser, something like 20 speed and 100 power to make sure you have a good bond. Or maybe this is a Yeti mug with different names, whatever. So now at this point, we are ready to say OK. And we are ready to go to our Layout tab and tell it what, one in the upper left-hand corner? No. We're going to use our Kershaw knife fixture by clicking the 18 knives. Excellent. Now, when we click on Print Preview, that is actually ready to print right away. Let's take a look at that in the preview screen to see what we have. We have non-printable layers hidden and locked, so we can't mess them up. But each one of these is a different name that's going to be engraved on that knife. And it only used up the amount that it needed to fill in the list of names. I hope you see that as a fantastic tool using the imposition layout tool, using print merge, using the envelope, and bringing in a CSV file. Maybe let's see if we could do that. Let's go back to our Kershaw knife. This is our template. You see the benefit of working on something other than our template, right? So if this is our print merge placeholder, let's see what would happen if we want to, we have this job saved already. Let's maybe close it down. And then let's open that right back up. Since I'm opening it up from a new session, I have the ability to create or load print merge. I don't want to create them from scratch anymore. I'm going to bring in a list or that CSV file. So if you have an Excel spreadsheet already created, you would choose this here. So I'm going to choose Open. And it was, see if I can find my shared folders from my desktop. And not an RTF file, but a comma separated value file. There I have my CSV. Here are my names. I'm ready to open. It's going to go out and grab those names and looks what it's done. If this would have been an Excel spreadsheet, a CSV, it would look the same way here. It's brought in the field name, and our names are listed right here. So we choose Next, Finish, and it is ready to perform or merge that to a new document. and it has merged all of that data with each name being set as a different page underneath. All right, let's go back to our agenda. So I hope you see that we have used many key elements in CorelDRAW here for this. Really, it's the meat and the heart of using CorelDRAW to create many different fixtures that you're going to have for the different objects that you're going to do over and over again, whether that be a dog tag, keychain, name badge. You know, your CO2 lasers can't slice through metal, but we have a lot of metal plates that you might order from a supplier, like a dog tag, and you want to create a fixture for all of those. Cell phones, cell phone covers, you name it. This has a lot of opportunity to get a lot of mileage from not only the fixturing, but also the print merge. So organizing your job so that some layers print and some layers are locked down and they're not movable would be very helpful to get used to using the Object Manager. And that boundary tool, after you have created the trace, how to create that outline from that shape. So I hope this has been very beneficial to you in using the fundamentals of CorelDRAW for imposition layout tool, the print preview screen, print merge, and making a fixture.